Hello everybody, Tyranno here, and welcome back to another episode of my proposed International Tank Tech Tree series. Now today we are looking at Finland, and again like with Egypt, there's only three vehicles, so this will be a shorter than average episode, but I will try and go into some detail about the vehicles featured on the tech tree that came from Finland or used by Finland. Now before we get onto Finnish tanks, I just want to look at the history of Finland during the time of War Thunder. It was actually part of the Russian Empire until 1917. The October Revolution had happened, Russia was going through revolution, and so the Finns decided to declare independence at the end of 1917. But in 1918 a civil war broke out between the White Finns and the Red Finns. I'm not a huge expert on the various political factions of Finland during this time, but the Whites were generally more conservative, they tend to be on the right of the political spectrum, and the Reds kind of wanted something similar to what Lenin was doing, socialism, and they tended to be on the left of the political spectrum. But the Whites won the Civil War, partly because they got quite a lot of help from the Germans. Remember, the Germans were actually doing quite well in World War I at this point, at least on the Eastern Front. The Russians were basically exhausted. They went to the peace treaty, or they went to sign a peace treaty, and then they didn't like the terms, so they just declared unilaterally, "We're not going to fight anymore, the war's over." Obviously, Germany predictably occupied a ridiculous amount of Russia at this point, which basically ended up with Russia giving a huge amount of territory to the Germans. So the Germans were in a strong position to sort of help the White Finns, and eventually they won. Now things were pretty calm until 1939, when the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact was signed between the Soviets and the Germans. Basically it assigned spheres of influence to the two nations, and Finland was assigned to the Soviet sphere of influence. The Soviets tried to acquire some territory off the Finns by negotiation. The Finns said no, so the Soviet Union shelled one of their own villages, Mainila, and then basically blamed it on Finland and invaded, thus starting the Winter War. And Finland was kind of expected not to do brilliantly well because it was a small, isolated country. But they actually did quite well militarily. They did eventually lose the war and had to give up like 10% of their country. But the Soviets lost something like over 100,000 men. The Finns lost like 20,000, I think. You know, it wasn't an easy victory as had kind of been expected, because the Soviets had purged all their experienced officers. Plus there may have been some underestimation of the Finns and maybe not particularly great equipment. So Finland, did well militarily. They sort of became allied, or maybe not allied, but more friendly towards the Germans after this point, because there wasn't really anyone else they could turn to. The only other people they could turn to were the British and French. Well, the French were gone by this point. They had sort of planned to send some equipment to the Finns and possibly even bomb some oil refineries in the Caucasus during the Winter War, but obviously the military situation with World War II had prevented that, but Finland actually joined in the Continuation War, which was basically what they called the invasion of Russia, or Soviet Union, during Operation Barbarossa. Now the Germans probably expected the Finns to help quite a lot, but the Finns really just sort of recaptured their territory they had lost, which, to be fair, the Soviets had taken from them illegally, but obviously the Western Allies couldn't support them now, because they were allied with the Soviet Union, so they declared war on Finland as well. Finland may have taken a bit of extra territory, but they didn't join in that vigorously. They didn't join in the Siege of Leningrad, which must have annoyed the Germans quite a bit. And by 1944, the Soviets were pushing them back, even with the German assistance. Now, in 1944, the Finns started to seek a separate peace treaty with the Soviets. They had promised the Germans they wouldn't do this, but the president had done it as a sort of personal promise, so he resigned and they sought a separate peace. And the Soviets basically agreed that the Finns had to give up the territory they'd lost in Winter War and a bit more territory. They had to pay a ridiculous amount of reparations, they had to demobilise the army, but they also had to evict the Germans in some like 14 days. Which is hard to do while you're demobilising. This led to the Lapland War. It lasted 7 months, but it was relatively low cost. I mean, like, lives. Destruction was quite high, but only something like 2,000 people were killed, which for a 7-month conflict isn't that bad. After the war, Finland didn't join the Warsaw Pact or the NATO forces. It basically adopted a position of neutrality, but it wouldn't criticise the Soviets, because obviously they were their neighbour and they were quite vulnerable, the Soviets could pressure them quite easily. But all in all, compared to other nations such as the Baltics, which were annexed by the Soviet Union for 50 years, So Finland came out pretty well. It took on the Soviets and the Germans, and while it lost 10% of its territory, or possibly more, it did ultimately keep its independence. But anyway, that's the history of Finland. Now to move on to the tanks of Finland. Now the first Finnish tanks we're going to be looking at are the Finnish variants of the Vickers 6-ton light tank. Now the Vickers 6-ton tank, as the name suggests, was developed by Vickers as a private project, but when they went to offer it for sale to the British Army, they didn't want it, or they couldn't afford it, so they started sending it to other countries. Some of you may actually recognise the tank, because some of them were sold to Russia or the Soviet Union, and they then improved the design a little bit and put it into production as the T-26 that we already have in game. One of the other countries the tank was sold to was, obviously, Finland, and they bought something like 30 or so of the tanks, 32 or 33, something around that number. But they had some weird requirements, or it seems weird at first. Basically, they didn't want any of the guns or the optics or radio equipment, which seems a bit odd, but it actually kind of makes a bit of sense. Basically, they wanted to equip it with their own guns and radio equipment. So, they were self-sufficient. They didn't want to be ordering radios from Britain or somewhere when they're at war with someone else, because obviously it wouldn't get there in time. It could be, the equipment could be sunk. If they're using Finnish equipment, then they should theoretically be self-sufficient and able to do replacements a lot easier. However, in practice, it didn't work out as well as it was meant to, because the guns weren't really put into production until 1939, early 1939, and a few months later, or in late 1939, the Winter War started, and none of the tanks had their guns equipped. Some of the guns were eventually produced and fitted to the Finnish tanks, but obviously the delay must have caused quite a few problems for the defence of Finland during this time. The gun used on the Finnish tanks was a 37mm Bofors gun, and it was meant to be quite a popular gun. As far as I'm aware, it was used by quite a few different nations: Sweden, Finland, I think Britain and Germany both used it during the Desert War. Apparently Finland kept some of the anti-tank versions around until the 80s, so, quite a popular gun. But it doesn't seem to be too much about penetration stats on it. The few places I did find some stats for the gun seemed to give some contradictory information. One of the sites I found did list the stats for the British Army Bofors 37mm, and said at something like 30 degrees at 1,000 metres it could penetrate about 40mm of armour, which would put the gun about at the same power as the Panzer III E and the M2 on the American territory. I also did find some stats on a website that deals with Finnish weapons, and it gave some quite not very believable stats, or perhaps I'm reading it wrong. It said at some like 70 degree angle it could penetrate 55mm at 100 metres, or about 44 at 500, or about 33 at 1000. Which again I find quite hard to believe. I mean, it's got a similar muzzle velocity to the cannon used on the M2. That can only do 22mm at 1000 metres at 60 degrees. This has got another 10 degrees and manages to penetrate an extra 10mm. The only figures that really made any sense to me, ironically, were the ones from Wikipedia, which, could be completely unreliable. But that said, at about 40mm at 300 yards, 33 at 457, 30 at 600 yards, 20 at 900, and 15 at 1200. Overall, I'd say this gun is probably comparable to the Panzer III's gun and the M2 gun, as I said at the beginning. So, we're talking about a very low tier gun, like battle rating 1.3, which, can affect the battle rating of the tank overall later on. Now, Vickers 6-ton tanks usually have about 13mm maximum armour, but I've seen some references that the variant ordered by the Finns actually had slightly thicker armour at about 17mm. For comparison, the Soviet T-26s have a maximum armour of 15, so this is 2mm thicker than the T-26s. Moving on to speed, the T-26 in game does about 19 miles per hour top speed, but could possibly be a bit heavier because it has a bigger gun, a different turret. Most 6-ton tanks could do, about 22 miles an hour. So presumably the Finnish tanks would do somewhere, it would probably do a bit more than 19 miles an hour, probably about 20-22 miles per hour, so reasonably fast. Now moving on to crew, the Finnish 6-ton tanks had 4 crew rather than the 3 used on the other 6-ton tanks. I believe the usual configuration was 3 crew, the Finnish version has 4. You had 2 people in the turret, the commander and either a gunner or a loader, depending on what the commander was doing. and then you had the driver at the front, but then you had a submachine gunner. No, that isn't actually a typo. Instead of having a machine gunner, bow machine gun, they decided to have someone with a submachine gun. I think that was on the left of the hole. I'm not entirely sure why they used a submachine gun. That seems like a really odd choice, if I'm honest. Now, there is another Vickers 6-ton tank we're going to be looking at in a minute, or slightly modified 6-ton tank, but where would I put this one on the tech tree? Well, I'd put it on the light tank line. Battle rating would have to be pretty low, probably about 1 to 1.3. It's very similar to the Soviet T-26 already in game, and that's only battle rating 1. The gun's similar to guns used on tanks at battle rating 1.3 at the most, so yeah, battle rating 1 to 1.3. I would like to see this tank added into the game. The only thing that could possibly really put me off of it is it's quite similar to the Soviet T-26, so you could get a few friendly fire incidents out of that. But hopefully if it, you know, has some extra prominent markings, maybe you could avoid that. But really, that's probably the one downside to it. But it would be nice to have it in the game, you know, to represent Finland during the Winter War. And I think it'd be a nice tank to have in War Thunder. Now, the next variant of the Vickers 6-ton I wanted to talk about actually came about because of the Winter War, and it's got a bit of an odd name, the T-26E. Like I said, the T-26 is a Russian tank. But basically, during the Winter War, or after the Winter War, Finland started replacing the turrets of the Vickers 6-ton tanks with the turrets from the Soviet T-26 with the 45mm gun. I think some of the optics were also upgraded, so that could be reflected in-game, you know, having more effective or different optics when, you know, in sniper view or aiming at other tanks. Now, as it would be using the 45mm gun, it makes sense it would get the ammunition for the 45mm gun already in-game. So, with armour-piercing high-explosive ballistic capped, at 100m 0 degrees it would do 59mm penetration, 45 at 500m, and 35 at 1000. Now, the 45mm gun is used on tanks up to the T-50, which is battle rating 2.7, so, you know, it probably wouldn't be that high, but, you know, it could potentially go that high and still be a somewhat useful gun. Now, the armour would presumably be very similar. Well, the hull would be unchanged, because obviously it was only the turrets that were really added onto the tank. The turrets could represent a bit of a downgrade or an upgrade, depending on what the armour was on the turrets of the original Vickers 6-ton tanks. I think they were originally something like 13mm on the turret. I think it's 15 on the T-26 turrets in-game already, so it could be a bit of an upgrade. But again, we're only talking about 1 or 2mm difference. Moving on to speed, again, it's got a turret with a bigger gun, so presumably it would be a bit slower. Possibly it would be the same speed as the T-26 in-game, about 19 miles per hour. So I'd say a ballpark about 20 miles per hour, probably, well, definitely slower than the original Vickers 6-ton variant. The crew for the T-26E was basically unchanged. Again, two people in the turret, a gunner and a loader, with the commander taking one of those roles. And again, you've got a driver and the whole submachine gunner. I actually looked up the submachine gun used by the whole gunner, because I was quite curious as to why, what was so good about this gun that they kept using it on their tanks. It turns out it's the Suomoi M1931. I actually have it in one of my books, but the name just didn't click with me straight away for some reason. But basically it was a ridiculously well-made, good quality submachine gun. Basically the whole gun was machined out of solid metal, and it was accurate up to ranges of something like 300m. So maybe this was a good alternative to a whole machine gun, because it was still accurate and fast firing. Maybe if the tank was knocked out, they could then continue as infantry as well. Not entirely sure why they used a submachine gun, but, you know, it's not as bad a decision as I thought it was when I was originally looking at this tank. One interesting fact I actually learnt about these tanks, they were delivered in the mid-30s as the original Vickers 6-tons, and then they were converted to the T-26Es, but they were actually kept in service until the late 50s or early 60s, presumably more as a training role, but these tanks were kept in service for a ridiculously long time. So where would I put this tank on the tech tree? Well, battle rating, I have put it at battle rating, well, I'd say it should be battle rating 1 to 1.3, because it is basically a T-26, but you know, with slightly more crew, it could possibly go up to 1.3 because it's got slightly better chance of surviving because it's got the extra crew. But as for where it actually goes on the tech tree itself, well, I spent a long time thinking about where it should go on the tech tree, and I ideally would like to see it on the medium lineup because it is an important Finnish tank. It kind of fits there weapon-wise. But it is also basically a T-26, but with an extra crewman. Visually, it looks the same. It would probably play the same. It basically is the same as a T-26, gameplay-wise. Then you'd probably get, you know, friendly fire incidents. Maybe Gaijin would come out and say, well, there's no point adding this tank because we basically have it in the game already as the T-26. I really want to see it on the medium lineup, but ultimately I've put it in the undersided slash premium lineup. Because it kind of makes more sense there, because it's basically a captured vehicle in a way. I mean, it's Finnish tanks, but with Russian weapons. So I'm a bit split. I would really like to see it on the medium lineup, but I think it would probably make more sense to go on the premium lineup. But either way, I'd really like to see this tank added to the game, because it was obviously an important Finnish tank, and I think it would do very well in War Thunder. Now, the last Finnish tank we're looking at is this rather odd-looking assault gun, the BT-42. Basically, the Finns took some captured BT-7s, and they added some 114mm howitzers that Britain had lent to the Finns during the Winter War. And it has a bit of an odd and not particularly great history. It wasn't a particularly well-liked vehicle, for reasons I'll explain in a minute. Now, looking at the stats, it does look okay on paper. It has an 114mm howitzer. You know, so that should give it a decent high explosive payload, and it can fire heat rounds. Now, the heat rounds it used were based on the German 105mm heat rounds, which seems to have caused some problems. I'm not sure if they built their own heat rounds to a similar design, or if they just took German heat rounds and sort of modified them to be fired out of a 114mm howitzer. But during testing, it was found to be able to penetrate, you know, quite well, 110mm of armour at something like a 72-degree angle. So they sent the BT-42s off to battle, where they were involved in the defence of Vyborg off Ipuri, and the shells completely failed. Basically, they just didn't work. One T-34 was hit something like 18 times at short range, and nothing happened to it. You know, the shells obviously weren't working very well. They'd worked in the tests, but in combat they just weren't working. I've seen some suggestions it might have been to do with the fuse. Maybe they'd done a bit of a design flaw, I'm not sure, but either way they didn't work as intended or as in the tests. Now, how it would perform in War Thunder really depends on why the shell wasn't working. If it's a malfunction problem, as in the shell wasn't working because it wasn't put together properly or it was damaged or something, then it should work perfectly fine in War Thunder, because War Thunder doesn't really represent those flaws in weapons and tanks. You know, it's the reason your tanks don't just randomly break down or catch fire or something. But if it's a design flaw, as in it was designed and, you know, the design was bad, it would never have worked anyway, then obviously it would have to be reflected in the game. But, well, the fact it was tested and it worked suggests it wasn't a design flaw. The fact that then some tanks fired multiple shells into enemy targets and couldn't do anything to them suggests it was a design flaw, though. Really, I'm not entirely sure. I think it probably was a bit of a malfunction rather than a design flaw, so it should probably perform quite well in War Thunder, but really it depends what, you know, other sources suggest. You know, I don't know if we could ever get a definite answer. Moving on to armour, it's not particularly great. The minimum something like 6mm. The maximum, I've seen some sources say 13, I've seen others say 20mm, but you know, it's pretty bad. You know, a machine gun could probably, well, 50 caliber machine gun can definitely penetrate that armour, which, you know, it kind of makes sense. It's on a light tank chassis, it's not like they could particularly up armour it that much. But looking at speed, I thought it would be quite slow, but nearly everywhere I've looked says it can do something like 50 kilometres an hour, which is roughly 30 miles an hour. Yeah, again, that's quite surprising. I would have thought it would be quite overloaded with that huge gun, but apparently not. As for crew, apparently there was only something like 3 crew. I'm guessing it would have been something like gunner and loader or something, and then driver. Maybe one, the commander would be taking one of the roles, it's either the gunner or the loader. But yeah, not many crew, not particularly great armour, some potential problems with the gun. It's got good fast speed though, so that's a plus point. So where would this go on the tech tree? Well, I'm going to put it in the assault gun lineup, because, you know, it is an assault gun. As for tier and battle rating, I'm going to be really generous and put it at tier 2, because really I'm not sure how well it would perform at tier 3, because again, the confusion over the ammunition and such. I'm going to put it battle rating 3.7. That's the same as the Stur 42G, which is a German tank destroyer with 105mm howitzer, which is also battle rating 3.7. The only other stuff that really seems similar is the SU-122, which is a battle rating 4, and the M4A3 with the 105mm gun, which is also battle rating 4. I don't know what the penetration of the high explosives on this would be, but I'm guessing they wouldn't be great, probably between 15 and 20mm. I'm also basing the battle rating on the assumption that the heat shells do work properly, but yeah, I think 3.7 is the best place for it. Of course, if the shells, you know, it turns out they were just broken by design, like, you know, they were designed improperly, it could go at a lower battle rating, because like I said, the high explosive shells may not be that good. So that was the BT-42, a bit of an unusual, not particularly great assault gun that, you know, didn't do very well during World War II. Yeah, I'd like to see it added to War Thunder. I think it would be quite an interesting vehicle, assuming it worked properly in-game. You know, and it would give the International Tech Trees something similar to the KV-2, although I doubt it would be as overpowered. But yeah, I'd like to see this added into the game. I think it's quite a nice little vehicle, and, you know, it does show, you know, some of the modifications Finland did make to some of the vehicles they captured. So now that we've looked at how Finland could contribute to the international tech tree with regards to tanks, how could it contribute with regards to events and maps and such? Well, it already has contributed with regards to maps. We already have Finland, the winter map. I think it was the first winter map added to the game. It's set near Matra. It was called Enso during the time of World War II. It's now called Svetogorsk, and that's sort of where the Finland map is based, or it's near to those areas, and, you know, it's a pretty good map, presumably to represent the continuation war and the winter war. So already with regards to maps, we do have some Finnish maps added into the game. You could possibly add some extra ones. With regards to events, well, there's a few different events you could do. The obvious ones would obviously be the winter war, the continuation war, the Lapland War, and possibly some hypothetical World War III situation where either NATO invades Finland or the Soviets invade Finland, or Finland teams up with either of those sides. You could also do some sort of alternate history type events. Perhaps during the Winter War, the Allied nations intervene in the war on the side of Finland, so you have Finland, Britain, France, and other Allied nations against the Soviets. Maybe the Allied nations invade Finland during the Continuation War, so Finland has to hold out against British and other Allied nations, and maybe the Soviets as well. You could do the Lapland War, maybe the Soviets and other Allied nations help out against the Germans. So as you can see, Finland could contribute quite a lot to events in War Thunder, because at the end of the day, there are lots of battles and wars to choose from when choosing to implement said events, and I think, you know, there are a lot of events that could involve Finland that would do very well in War Thunder, and I do hope they could be incorporated in the event of the International Tech Tree being added to War Thunder. So that's it for this episode looking at Finland. Next episode we're going to be starting with France, and France, as you can see here, has got the most tanks of the Tech Tree, 31. I may have to actually update that count by the next episode, because I'm probably going to be adding some more vehicles or taking some away. But by far, France is going to be contributing the most to the tech tree, so that will probably be done over multiple episodes. You can see Finland with 3 tanks is going to be nearly a half-hour episode, with France with 31. I'm either going to have to cut down on, you know, the information about vehicles, or I'm just going to have to do lots and lots and lots of episodes. But I'll try and do, like, one for each lineup at least. But anyway, that's it for this episode. I hope you enjoyed it. Leave a like if you did. Subscribe if you like these sorts of videos. Leave feedback, could always do with more feedback. And yeah, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time. And as usual, if you enjoyed that episode, then don't forget to check out the other episodes popping up on screen now.